Amen, amen. How y'all feeling this afternoon? Well, you know God has already done a whole lot in this service, amen. And I wanted to just say welcome to everybody that took time to be here today. And I know church is not a social place in that regard. It's church. But I know that sometimes people need to be encouraged. So I wanted to tell you thanks for taking time to be with us this afternoon. And this is it. We have church.
We want
to pray
here
against those demonic forces that are behind the addiction.
Amen.
Have you guys ever heard the terminology trying to put a Band-Aid on a gunshot wound?
Yeah.
That's what we do when we attack spiritual things in natural ways. When we don't deal with the demonic things that are behind addiction, we are putting a Band-Aid on a gunshot wound. But when we go into the Spirit, right? And we go with the power of the Spirit, we go and we bind those things, because God said he gave us the ability to bind. Whatever we bind on earth will be bound in heaven. Whatever we loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Amen? And some of us in this room who have been addicted, I'm preaching good. Some of us in this room who have been, used to be, like like little Kirk used to say, he didn't say once upon a time, he said, pana upon a time. Pana upon a time, those of us in this room who used to be addicted and are no longer addicted. We need to understand that we have a powerful prayer because we know what the power of God can do. We know that God can move and God can bind and God can release and God can free us of those addictions. So we need to be praying day in and day out for all those who are drug addicted in the Coachella Valley and praying against the spirit, the principalities that's behind it.
Yes.
Amen?
Amen?
That means any type of drug. Even if the doctor writes you a cute prescription every month. Prescription drugs?
Preacher.
Any type of addiction. We want to pray against the addiction and pray for the addicted. And we claim that God is going to move in a mighty way. So every day this month, let's pray for them in the name of Jesus. Amen? That's what we're going to do. They need some help, y'all. They need some help. And I was asking the Lord, what can we do? Lord, what can we do? He said, pray.
Come on.
He says the effectual fervent prayer of a righteous person avails much. It makes things happen.
Yes.
We don't have to go there. We don't have to go talk to them. We send the prayers on their behalf. It's intercession. Amen?
Yes.
Bless the Lord. Let's stand up and go into the word this afternoon. We're on the subject, why you need the baptism. Amen?
Amen.
Acts 19, 1 through 6. Once you get to say, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Yep, I'm going to need some help today, y'all. We're going to do some heavy lifting. Amen?
Amen?
Acts 19, 1 through 6. Once you get to say, thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Come on, y'all. Come on, y'all. Act like you already ate today.
Yeah.
Acts 19, 1 through 6. Once you get to say, preach, preacher.
Preach, preacher.
Amen. With the help of the Lord, that's what I plan on doing. I'm going to read two different versions. And it says, it came to pass that when Apollos was at Corinth, Paul, having passed through the upper coast, came to Ephesus. And finding certain disciples, say disciples.
Disciples.
Say disciples are followers.
Disciples are followers.
All right. He said unto them, have ye received the Holy Ghost since you believed? And they said unto him, we have not so much as heard whether there be any Holy Ghost. They didn't know. And he said unto them, until then, what baptism were you baptized? And they said unto John's baptism. Y'all say John.
John.
Say not Jesus.
Not Jesus.
John.
John.
All right, y'all can preach that right there. Y'all got the word. Then said Paul, John verily baptized with a baptism of repentance, saying unto the people that they should believe on him which should come after him, that is on Christ Jesus. When they heard this, say when.
When.
Say when.
When.
Say when.
When.
Amen. When they heard this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. And when Paul had laid his hands upon them, the Holy Ghost came on them, and they spake with other tongues and prophesied. Y'all get all that?
Amen.
Y'all got that?
Yes.
I'm just going to read that version today, but I'm going to read this sixth verse. When the followers heard this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. Then Paul laid his hands on them, and the Holy Spirit came on them. They began speaking different languages and prophesying. Amen? All right, let us pray. Dear gracious Father God, we just come before you, Lord, just thanking you for all things, Lord. I just ask you just use me as an oracle. Father God, that brings a word right now for a right now generation, for a right moment people. Father God, I claim that this time was ordained before the foundation of the world. So right now, the word that's going to come forth is for right now. It's going to quicken, Father God. It's going to shake up. It's going to stir. But it's going to be your word, and it's going to be true. So, Father God, separate me from myself. I do not want to be seen, and I do not want to be heard. I want people to hear what thus saith the Lord. And when the word is spoken, let it not fall on deaf ears or hardened hearts. But you watch over to make sure it does not return unto you void. Your word is alive and well, and it shall be taught and preached today, bringing you honor and glory in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. All I need is a little bit of permission. If you give me permission, I'll let go. You know, I just need a little permission, and I'll let go. Because everything that God gave me, I'm supposed to share anyhow. I believe that God's too good to just keep to yourself. He gets better and better. Like some people say, he gets gooder and gooder the more you share him. Amen? But I'm glad I'm in church today. I'm so glad I'm in church today. Because so many places, the life of the Christian is just being snuffed out. In so many places, it's not cool to profess your Christianity and your faith. In so many arenas nowadays, and it happened quick, y'all. In so many places, it's not okay to say, I'm a follower of Jesus Christ.
Come on.
In so many places you get dinged, or you get a demerit, or you get something put against you when you stand up and say, I believe in Jesus Christ. Because you know what they start doing to the church? They're starting to push the church around.
Come on, talk a little bit.
They're starting to finagle the church. They're starting to manipulate the church. They're starting to do stuff to the church. I'm going to let you guys in on a secret. About 3 years ago when we opened the church, a little bit after 3 years, about 3 months in, I got a letter, y'all. Letter came to my address. Tony Williams came to my home address. Y'all, the mailman brought it himself. For real. And I'm going to tell you guys what the content, basic content of his letter said. It says, we have been watching you. And we see what you are doing. We know that you are going into a powerful place in your life. So what we would like for you to do is join our society where you can have more power, you could have more influence, and you could have more money than you've ever had before. All you have to do is respond to this letter and join us. And guess what I said? The devil is a lie. I'm not lying. That's a real life letter I got. They knew what the Spirit was doing already in Love of Christ Community Church. They knew that people were going to be healed, that people were going to be free, and people were going to be delivered. They thought I was going to take the bait and take the money and turn my back on God. But I said the devil is a lie, because I know the difference between what's right and what's wrong. They wrote me a letter.
Come on.
I'm not lying. They wrote me a letter. That's my wife. I told her about it. I didn't let her see it. They try to talk me out of my calling, y'all. They try to get me to shut down the church, y'all, and start chasing things, y'all. They wanted me to get famous again and be my own idol again, y'all. But I already knew the works of the devil. Because I didn't get on my knees at that moment. I was on my knees before the letter came. See, but too many of the church people have started taking the bait, y'all.
Yes.
Too many people, them people out there don't even forgive me. Don't forgive me. I talk to anybody that professes to be a pastor, a preacher, a teacher. I don't mind.
That's right.
But if you're taking the bait, then you might as well get out of business. Yeah. If you're falling and sipping on the Kool-Aid, you might as well pack up. Because right now, Love of Christ Community Church is steaming through with the power of the Holy Ghost, and we're not going to stop. If you playing church, it's time for you to get on. If you're not going to get it right with God, get on. People playing too much. People accepting too much.
Come on.
People putting out too much.
Come on.
That ain't right. People building their personal kingdoms instead of the kingdom of God. People searching for their own glory instead of saying, to God be the glory. People want their names to be on their mouth instead of the name of Jesus to be on people's mouth. Do not take 1 minute to idolize me. Don't exalt the teacher. Don't exalt the pew. Lift him up. Lift him up. Lift the world, the Savior up, so the world can see. He said, if I be lifted up from the earth, I'll draw all men unto me. If we lift up Jesus, Jesus himself, the world will see the difference and the world will change.
Yeah. Come on.
But see, this is what's happening.
Come on.
Listen. We have too many intellectuals in the church.
Come on. Go ahead. Go ahead.
We have scholars, but they're not reading the Bible in the church.
Come on.
We have life coaches up here as pastors.
Come on.
We have sultans and gurus.
Come on.
Instead of people that's on their face fasting and praying in the Holy Ghost.
Come on.
We got people that's trying to find something about you instead of me speaking from the pulpit and the minister speaking from the pulpit, speaking right into your heart, because I don't know anything about you, but God knows everything and he's talking to you through me because I've been with him. That's what you need. See, I think the church is taking a long nap. The church is acting like Rip Van Winkle. Y'all know that story? Went to sleep for 20 years. And when he woke up, his beard was all long. Time had passed by and things had changed. Don't you know that the church is standing right here and the world is just messing us up and passing us by like we sleep and we don't stand up and say, wait a minute, I stand on the rock of Jesus Christ and those things are not allowed in the world that I live in. I'm light and I'm salt and I'm here to change this thing. You know what it's like?
Come on.
It's like me and my brother. Me and my brother used to fight a little bit. We did. You guys, daddy, we used to fight. But most of the time, I started a fight. I did. My brother didn't want to fight. He didn't want to beat me up. He could beat me up. He didn't want to beat me up. But so, hey, man, I was just a mean kid. But I learned, you know, there was things that you could do, right? Put your stick on his shoulder, right? Y'all know that one? I'm from Missouri, y'all. I'm from the Show Me State. Upperwear's down and dirty. It's tough in Missouri. It's tough, y'all. Put a stick on the shoulder. If you knock the stick off, he knocked the stick off, y'all start fighting, right? Another one was that you draw a line in the sand. If he crossed that line, as soon as he crossed the line, you start fighting. You know what I mean? But at least, come on, I'm trying to preach to y'all, church. But at least I knew when somebody knocked the stick off my shoulder, I was about to get into a fight. So I had to decide if I was going to fight, if I was going to run, if I was going to try, if I was going to get my butt beat, I was going to fight or not. And I knew if they passed the line, as soon as you passed the line on me, I was a stealer. I never liked to hit second. You passed that line, boy, it was on. I tried to win. But I knew what the line was for. The church is so asleep, we don't even know that the devil has crossed the line. He's knocked off all the sticks off my shoulder. He's called us out. He's called us punks. He's messing with everything that we love. We don't even know he's already up in our camp and taking everything from us. Church is going to sleep more scared than the world. Church is more scared than the church has ever been before. Church is backing up harder than man. I used to backpedal for a living. Church is backpedaling hard. Trying to get, how do we say this? Man, you say it like it is.
Right.
Some things just ain't right with God.
Right.
Some things just don't float in his kingdom. Some things just are not right as far as lifestyle. We gotta just tell it like it is.
Right.
But the churches got encroached upon. The devil's all the way over here. I would tell it like this. You know, if you come to my house, which you can come, you can eat anything in my house except for what? There you go. Everybody knows. Everybody knows. See, my wife don't even know, but I got me a box here right now. I love some Twinkies, right? I love me some Twinkies. You can have a T-bone steak, you can have a rib, I'll cook for you. I'll do everything. I'll make you Kool-Aid. I'll give you soda, whatever. But when you have some dessert, please do not reach for my Twinkies. Please. That's where I separate things. That's where I lose it. Things just ain't normal when you mess with my Twinkies. It becomes a problem, and real quick. I forget that you're my guest. And now it's got to be on. Do not, by any means, grab my Twinkies. Amen? And we'll be all right. See, it's like this. It's like the devil has come up into my house. And he didn't ask for nothing else. He just going straight to my pantry and he taking my Twinkies. He got the box in his hand and he's eating on one and got the whole box and said, what you gonna do about it? You don't believe the gospel that you preach. What you gonna do about it? You don't believe in that God that said he could do anything. What you gonna do about it? You scared just like the rest of the world is. What you gonna do about it? Well, I'm telling you what I'm about to do. I'm about to take my Twinkies, slap them in his mouth, tell him to go to the store and give me 5 more boxes. That's what I'm about to do. That's what I'm about to do. I'm gonna slap the taste out of his mouth. And then I'm making him go to Ralph's or Stater Brothers and give me 5 more boxes. And bring them back and put them where he took the one from. The church just forgetting we're supposed to be the church. The church is forgetting what we're supposed to stand for. The church is forgetting that we're supposed to be about our Father's business. Yeah. If I tell you right now, what is your Father's business? You'll start telling me, well, my father's a plumber. No, he's not. Well, my father works for AT&T. No, he don't. I'm not talking about your physical daddy. I'm talking about the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. What's your Father's business? What are you supposed to be doing with what God gave you? That's what I'm talking about. The church has forgotten that we got a mission and a mandate from the Lord to go into the world and preach the gospel unto every creature. We act like if you don't come to church, I can't say nothing to you about God. My God, most people don't come to church. We got to take God to the people. But no, people want entertainment.
Come on.
They want me to make them feel good every time I preach. I'm not going to do it. I'm going to preach whatever God tell me that week, and that's it. Like it or hate it, love it or hate it, that's what's going to come out my mouth. Church found it trying to be too friendly. The word says to be friends with the world, to be enemy with God. Hello? That's what the word says, y'all. But shouldn't we just allow everybody to be how they are? Well, look at what's happening since we allow everybody to be how they are. I'm just going to say this one thing, then I'm going to stick and move. When I grew up, I went to the boys' restroom because my daddy told me, you're a boy. Help me out, church. I couldn't wake up in the morning on every other Wednesday and I was something else. Come on, y'all, help me out. How crazy does that sound? I wake up this morning and I feel kind of like a girl. So therefore, today I'm wearing pink and pastelis. Oh, come on, y'all, help me out. And I'll go to the other restroom because that's how I feel. And by the way, the government is backing me up, so you can't do nothing to me. Oh, they signed an executive order that said, you gotta let me go. I feel like a little girl. Let me go to the girls' restroom. Oh, y'all don't want to hear the truth. Y'all don't want to hear the truth. Everybody want to be kind and friendly. I'm trying to tell you, I don't want no girls or no boys showing up in the girls' restroom. If you don't have the girl appendages, you don't have the girls' stuff down here, don't go in the girl restroom. That's not where you belong. You go into the other restroom. And tell them that I said to go into the right restroom. Yeah. Everybody's scared. Everybody's scared. Church is scared. Talking about we can't be the, if we're not gonna be the church, then what we gonna be? If we are not the church, then what are we? Help me out. If we're not, Rev, help me out.
A part of the church.
If we're not the church, then what are we? We lukewarm. The Lord said, I wish that you were either hot or cold. But since you lukewarm, I'm going to spit you out. Amen. He said, either be hot or be cold, but don't perpetrate.
That's right.
Right? And I don't hate anybody. I do not hate anybody. But I could tell you like this. I am not going to sit back and be in my right mind and be in my spiritual mind and watch this hell break loose right before me and act like it's okay. It's not okay. Some things are just dead wrong. They're dead wrong. All right? All right? I'm tired.
Come on.
I'm tired of people getting up in the pulpit and just tickling your ears. Because if they preach the truth with conviction and with boldness, you say, I'm not coming back. That's not of God, because everything of God makes me feel good. God sent Jesus to the cross. I bet that didn't feel good.
That's right.
You know why I know I'm telling the truth? You know how I know? Because I had my win opportunity. Oh, y'all didn't hear me. I had a win, W-H-E-N, opportunity. See, I believed in the Lord. I repented of my sins. And I knew about him. I was studying his word. I was going to his house. But somebody asked me, have you been filled with the Holy Ghost since you believed? And my response was, I haven't heard such a thing as there's a Holy Ghost. And they told me, well, what have you been baptized into? I said, well, I repented of my sins. They said, that's good. That'll get you saved. They said, but do you want to go all the way? Do you want to get everything? This is how you know when the devil's crossed the line, when you're filled with the Holy Ghost. Oh, preach, preacher. This is how you know when the devil's grabbing your Twinkies, when you're filled with the Holy Ghost. This is how you can stand in the middle of death and destruction and not be moved, because you're filled with the Holy Ghost when everybody else is in a panic and everybody else is afraid and everybody else is running the other way. You can stand still because you say, no weapon that's formed against me shall be able to prosper, because I'm filled with the Holy Ghost. I had a win opportunity. When they told me that you could be filled and you need to be filled with the Holy Ghost, because there's a battle that's coming. And you can't fight this battle with your knuckles. You can't fight this battle with your fists. You can't fight this battle with your own mind. You got to be equipped and grounded and rooted and filled with the Holy Ghost. I said, if a battle's coming, I've always been a fighter. Get me that weapon so I can win the fight. They said, you got to be baptized in the Holy Ghost. See, sometimes when people, since I'm going to tell you that, you need that baptism. I'm gonna tell you that. You go say other churches never told me that. Wow. No preacher ever told me that. Wow. My Sunday school teacher didn't tell me. Wow. The pastor never preached on anything about the Holy Ghost. Wow. If you look into your Bible, you start when Jesus resurrected. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Acts. They call it Acts of the Apostles, but it's actually the Acts of the Holy Ghost. That's what the book is about, the Acts of the Holy Ghost. As soon as John is done, the Acts begin, and the church is started, and the church starts with the infilling and the power of the Holy Ghost. I came to petition you today to say that same power that started the church is the same power that's necessary in the church. Now, right now, today. So nobody ever told you about the Holy Ghost.
Come on.
You know, sometimes I tell it like this. The best way I can say it, I played football in the 80s and 90s, right? We didn't do what the boys can do today, right? But see, but we can do what the boys in the 70s and the 60s couldn't do. Oh, come on, y'all. But we couldn't do what these guys do today. The moves that Michael Jordan made, other people making them and then some. But see, Mike couldn't do it before he saw somebody else do something. Oh, I'm trying to build something, y'all. It takes a new generation to pick up from what the old generation did and take it to the next level. See, that's what the win, opportunity, and the baptism of the Holy Ghost allows the church to do. We've seen old saints laid out. We've seen old saints praying and walking the floor all night. But see, when the infilling of the Holy Ghost happens, it's just something about, you know, when spiritual warfare is going on. You know that there's some blood, there's some guts, there's some sweat, and there's some tears. Amen? But we need to understand this, that if the church hasn't been taught about the power and the infilling and the necessity of the Holy Ghost, does not mean that the church does not need it. So I'm just gonna say this. I'm filled with the Holy Ghost. That's how I do everything I do for God. It's by that power. It's not Tony's power. It's not my strength. It's not my intellect. It's not my charm. It's not my charisma. It's none of that. What it is the power of the Holy Ghost. Plain and simple. One day I got filled with the Holy Ghost and I began to speak with other tongues. And from that day forward, I got stronger and I got stronger. And I got stronger and I got stronger. I got more grounded. I got more rooted. I'm not worried about if somebody don't like me. That's not a concern to me. You know what? You know what? Some people are going to like you. They're going to like you so much they're not going to tell you the truth. And they're going to like you so much that they're not going to tell you the truth. You don't get an opportunity at the truth. And them not liking you is going to lead you right to hell. And hell is forever.
You no coming back?
No, ain't no coming back.
Right.
There's no mulligans. There's no do-overs. There's no I got it nows. Okay. Oh, Lord, this is what you meant, hell. I thought you meant swell. No, I meant hell, right? Ain't no coming back. People will like you a whole bunch and they'll feed you this garbage. They'll tell you such things as there is no hell. Well, go to Matthew, the 25th chapter. Where the word doesn't say there is no hell. It says hell, God did not make hell for man, but he made it for the devil and his angels. He did not say that you can't go under your own free will. Oh, yes, you can. People like you so much that they're going to leave you with half truths. They're going to tell you that do this, do that, do this, do that. You're going to have a house on the hill. And it's never going to, you know what, at your house on the hill is never going to be a bad day. Your wife is always going to say, oh, my prince. You came home again, just like Christina. Man, I don't believe that story all the way, Q. She just sits there and smiles at me all the way till we go to bed. I don't believe that story all the way. I know he didn't say that, but I'm messing with him, y'all. I got the mic right now. Right? I'm going to teach you how to get a house up on the hill. And at the house up on the hill, your wife is always going to call you nice things. And it's always going to be sweet. It's always going to be pleasant. It's always going to be perfect. Come on, y'all. People tell you, hey, because of the grace of God, you can do anything. Come on, y'all. I'm trying to help you out. The grace of God allows you to just do anything. That's what they teach it. They're not saying that the grace of God allows you into a relationship where you get to a point where you know what you're, when you're offending your father, when you're hurting him, and you just don't do the things because your character is changing. When your character changes, the less grace you need. Your character don't change unless you're filled with the Holy Ghost. You cannot change your character to a character that's pleasing to God without the power of the Holy Ghost becoming the change agent and making the power work in you. Praise the Lord. Oh, yeah, y'all just want me to tell y'all that grace is a get out of jail free, sin free card, huh? Let me tell you this. If you act a fool with your wife all the time, you're going to get grace all the time? Preacher, you act a fool with God, you're not going to get grace all the time. It's going to be a rebuke. He's going to kick you in the behind. He's going to spank that butt. He's going to shake you up. He's going to tell you, you better get it right. I'm not accepting this stuff. If y'all stay asleep, if the church stays asleep, if the church keep on napping, keep on taking an extra long lunch break thinking you're getting away with something. If the church keep on blending in and morphing into the world, if the church keeps on acting and reacting and thinking and doing just like everybody else, then what have we become? I'm trying to give you a W-H-E-N opportunity. Yeah. I'm trying to tell you that right now, the only way you're going to be able to understand anything that's going on in the world is being filled with the Holy Ghost. People are going to be so confused in today's time. They're going to be so messed up in today's time. They're going to be so jacked up because they're not filled with the Holy Ghost. I'm not trying to put no fear in you. But let me tell you what that word need means. To require something because it is essential or very important rather than just desirable. You don't need to be filled with the Holy Ghost to be cute. To show somebody I got it. Listen to me, pray. That's not what you need it for. You need it because it's essential and very important, not more rather than just desirable. Is to be under the necessity or the obligation. It means a condition or a situation where something must be supplied in order for a certain condition to be maintained. Ooh. In order for us to maintain our status as God's church, come on. We need the infilling of the Holy Ghost. Yep. Or desired a state or a desired state to be achieved. It means you have to have it. Why do you need the baptism? I'm gonna tell you one reason, then I'm gonna let you go today, okay? Can I give y'all one? Yeah. Y'all gotta just give me about 10 minutes. I'm not lying. Give me about 10 minutes, then make a beep noise or stand up, something. Give me 10 minutes. But I'm about to go in for, I'm going in for 10. Okay. All right? Why you need it? It builds you up, it builds your faith and your spirit. Amen. The book of Jude is only one chapter, says, but you beloved, 120, you beloved, building up yourselves on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. Dear friends, keep building on the foundation of your most holy faith. Another verse says, as the Holy Spirit has you to pray or leads you to pray, helps you to pray. But you beloved, keep building up yourselves on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. Praying in the Holy Ghost, praying in tongues builds you up. Hello? Hello? 1 Corinthians 14:2 says, but anyone who speaks in a tongue does not speak to people, but to God. So when I'm praying, I'm not speaking to you. I'm speaking to God. And then when people say there needs to be an interpretation, that one didn't say it needs an interpretation. Let me tell you what the real thing is that needs an interpretation. There's a gift of speaking in tongues that needs an interpretation. This speaking in tongues is a personal interpretation, a gift between you and God. It's not the gift of speaking in tongues. That's why when the word says, do all speak in tongues, it's talking about the gift. There's a difference between filled with the Holy Ghost and having a gift of speaking in tongues. This one that we do does not require an interpretation. Preach, preacher, the truth. You shall know the truth, and the truth will make you free. For if anyone who speaks in a tongue does not speak to people but to God, indeed no one understands them, they utter mysteries by the Spirit. But the one who prophesies speaks to people for their strengthening and encouraging and comfort. Anyone who speaks in tongues edifies themselves. But the one who prophesies edifies the church. So it builds you up. I'm talking about building you up. I'm going to give you another scripture. 1 Corinthians 14:39 says, therefore, my brothers and sisters, be eager to prophesy and do not forbid speaking in tongues. Woo-wee. Amen. Amen. Now, why do you need to be built up? Cardiovascular or cardio training builds up your physical stamina, right? That's people that get on a treadmill, go walk, and go for a run, go for a jog, run a marathon, if you will, right? It enables you to last longer doing physical activities. Weight training builds up your muscles. And it builds up your muscles by first ripping those muscles. And when you rip those muscles, they repair and they become thicker. That's how the guys got so big or women got so big, is that those muscles and those tendons have been ripped and then they had to repair. They rip and they get bigger every time, so it takes more and more to rip them. What that is a place of them getting stronger so that they do not endure the same trauma. Preach, preacher. I'm trying to tell you why you need to be built up. It rips them up, it tears them down, then they get built back up, which gives you gains in strength and has its benefits in arenas, an arena that strength is needed. In either case, in cardiovascular or in weight training, in many ways, there's many ways and reasons why you do it. But the end result is there's a regimen of activities necessary to achieve these benefits. Your spirit needs constant exercising in order to gain in strength. As your spirit gains, your flesh subsides and decreases.
Amen.
Strength and influence and appetite. You are being built up for some impending battles you will face. And check this out. You're not just being built up for the battles that you're going to face. You're being reconditioned for the battles that you've already endured.
Amen.
Amen.
Oh, are we about to shout? This is what that means. You praying in the Holy Ghost is building you up for things that you're going to endure because the battle is coming.
Amen.
You praying in the Holy Ghost is giving you wisdom about the things that you've already overcome.
Yes.
Oh, preach, preacher.
Yes.
The things that you've already overcome, you're done with as far as being overcomers. Let me tell it like it is. You used to wake up in the middle of the night, go to the dope man house and say, I gotta get a hit.
Yeah.
And you didn't have enough money. So you had to get it on credit. I'm preaching for real, y'all. And the dope man gave you some. And it made you degraded. And you came down, and you felt like less than a human being. You felt stripped and naked everywhere that you go because they said, look at that dope fiend. Look at that strawberry. Look at that clucker. Look at that stuff. I'm trying to tell you, now since you've been built up in the Holy Ghost, you look back at that and say, my God protected me when I was going through the worst time of life. He had his angels around me so nothing could harm me. I went through that valley and I made it through because God had me covered. When you fill with the Holy Ghost, you don't look back at that shame and degradation and say, look how dirty and filthy I was. You say, look how powerful and how loving. He loved me so much, I don't know why. Oh my God, it reconditions you for what you've been through. Woo-wee! Come on, y'all. That thing that's supposed to make you shame is a shouting thing. The thing that's supposed to make you feel bad, once you get reconditioned, it's a joy thing. Oh my God, the thing that had you laid out is the reason why you spin and jump for joy now. Woo! Wait! You get built up for right now and built up for then. Oh my God, God is a good God. If he's working it out right now, he's working out your right now and your future at the same time while he's working out your past.
Yeah.
Come on, y'all. Come on, y'all. Give God some glory. Hallelujah. Let's give the Lord some glory. Hallelujah. That's right. I can't do that if I wasn't filled with the Holy Ghost. That's revelation that I don't have the power to understand. But when God wrote it down, had me write it down, I knew it in my spirit. Amen? And I knew people was gonna shout. Because that's the truth, amen? Now you look at your past a little different. Because you have the infilling of the Holy Ghost. While you're getting equipped for your future, and while you're getting equipped to deal with right now, you're getting a reboot and a redo and an understanding of what your past is. Oh my God, is he too good? And you know how he can do it? You know how he can do it? Because he created time. But he's not bound by time. He's not in time because he is. You know where he is? He's in your past. You know where he is? He's in your present. And you know where he is? He's in your future. He is. That's how he can do it. That's how he can do it. Because he is. The constant. He is. He is. My God. Hey, I promise y'all something, and I'm letting it go. I'm letting it go. But the reason why you needed the baptism is to build yourself up. And you know when the Lord says, I know the plans I have for you in Jeremiah 29:11, right? The plans, let's look at the plans like this. The plans that built this building before this building became, there were the plans, y'all. And the plan called for things that we don't even see inside of the walls, underneath the ground, but they're there, y'all. You know how we know that they're there? Because there was an inspector that had to come and check every step of the way. When you want to dig the footings, he has to come and see, or she has to come and see they're right or they're wrong. Preach, preacher. I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord. And then before they pour the slab, they got to come over, Brother Andy, help me out. Brother Andy's a builder. They got to come check. And after you pour the slab, Brother Andy, they have to come check. And then when you want to start building the walls, I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord. Before they can start building on the walls, they got to make sure that everything's right. After they put the walls, before they put the roof on, they have to make sure everything's right. I know the plans I have for you. And when it's all said and done, the plans match up with the building. Because the building was built on the proper plans. And if the plans weren't proper, the building wouldn't be proper. If the inspections didn't occur, the building wouldn't be proper. So you need to be built up, because sometimes you're going to get your plans inspected. Sometimes you're going to go through some checks, and you got to be right. You see, if your footings aren't right, the building won't be right. See, so when you endure, when you're in the battle, and you're at the end of your rope, don't give up. Just say it's inspection time. And then say, I know the plans that you have for me, Lord. This is not it. And then when the next layer happens and you get another inspection, say it's just inspection time. And look at the Lord and say, Lord, I know the plans that you have for me. This is not it. And then when the next thing happens and you come to a storm in life and something bad and crazy just happens, say, I know this ain't it, because, Lord, I know the plans you have for me. And as time goes on, before you know it, because you built on a rock and your faith is growing, because you prayed in the Holy Ghost, because you talked to God and you got stronger and stronger and stronger, you can stand up and say, but I went through hell to get here. I went through hell, but I'm standing. It was tough, but I made it. I was strong enough because I had God on my side. I know the plans he has for you. He's not done with you yet. You might be going through something that's real tough right now, but that's not it. It's just inspection time. But you need that baptism. You need to be filled with the Holy Ghost so that you can withstand the impending hurricane and the forces that are coming against you, so you can stand no matter what. Let's stand up.
Surely the breath.